Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin shattered the gender barriers of the early 20th century to become one of the most influential female physicists and astronomers to date. Her work and her example have helped to shape the modern world of women in science. Her passion for the sciences outweighed society's perceived role of women in the science field, and her passion also led her to leave her native country of England to pursue opportunities in the United States. After I learned of Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin's story, I was struck by her strength in the face of adversity, as well as her massive achievements in the field of astronomy. I have always loved science and mathematics myself, and as a student at an all-girls school, I believe wholeheartedly in the potential for women to achieve in all fields, and I look up to professional, influential women. Women can and should shatter the stereotypes surrounding the field of science. Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin, often referred to as the woman who discovered the universe, was a woman before her time. She attended Cambridge University before women were even allowed to obtain a diploma, and she went on to become the first person to receive a PhD in astronomy from Radcliffe College, a part of Harvard University. According to Otto Struve, her doctoral thesis, Stellar Atmospheres, was undoubtedly the most brilliant PhD thesis ever written in astronomy. Despite minimal recognition for her scientific breakthroughs, such as her discovery that the universe is mostly composed of hydrogen, she eventually became the first female department head at Harvard.
She was the first department, she established the astronomy department. She was the first woman chair at Harvard University. So in a way she was a revolutionary figure. She also discovered something extremely important scientifically. She found that the sun is made of hydrogen, which happens to be the most abundant element in the universe. And when she came up with this conclusion in her PhD thesis, a lot of people found it surprising, including the experts, like Henry Norris Russell, who was the director of the Princeton Observatory. And he tried to prove her wrong. He thought that she's probably mistaken, because people thought that the sun is made of the same composition as the Earth. They knew about the composition of the Earth, and they thought it's very likely that the sun is made of the same materials. So he followed her studies and gathered additional data, and they realized that she was right and admitted that. So her discovery is actually extremely important, because nowadays we know that most of the universe is made of hydrogen. It's the most abundant element. And we understand why it is, because it's the simplest atom. It's made of a proton and an electron, and she was the first to discover that fact.
Not only was Payne-Gaposchkin an incredible astronomer, but she was a fascinating and well-rounded woman as well. She was born Cecilia Helena Payne in England in 1900. She was a member of the American Astronomical Society, International Astronomical Union, and American Philosophical Society. She was a violinist, poet, avid reader, author, wife, and mother. She received the Mary Ewart Scholarship for Natural Sciences to Newnham College, Cambridge University, in 1919, studying botany, physics, and chemistry there. She graduated in 1923 before coming to America to perform research at the Harvard College Observatory as a National Research Fellow. She was the first person to receive the Annie J. Cannon Prize in 1934. At Harvard, she became the Phillips Astronomer in 1938, and Professor of Astronomy and Chairman of the Department of Astronomy in 1956, according to her autobiography. After retiring, she continued to research until her death in 1979. In The Starry Universe, the Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin Centenary, Owen Gingerich wrote, "Our paths came together in my first semester in graduate school, when I enrolled in her Introduction to Observational Astrophysics." He continued, "Mrs. G. told me how she had been converted to astronomy. She had heard a lecture by Arthur Eddington on relativity, and had been so impressed that she went back to her room and copied it all out." He continued, "Clearly, I was destined to be her thesis student." I knew Mrs. G for just over 30 years, more than half the time she spent at Harvard.
When I was admitted to graduate school here, there were six of us, and we were all men. And in the next few years, there may have been one or two women, but not that many. But Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin was the first, and she was a woman. When Cecilia Payne was here, the idea of having a woman professor was just unthinkable. And she eventually became the first woman professor who had essentially come up through the ranks. She felt that in England, the only possibilities would be school teaching. And she was interested in the possibility of doing research, and so she had that opportunity.
On the subject of being a woman, Payne-Gaposchkin wrote in her autobiography, "A woman knows the frustration of belonging to a minority group. We may not actually be a minority, but we are certainly disadvantaged. Early experience had taught me that my brother was valued above me. His education dictated the family moves. He must go to Oxford at all costs. If I wanted to go to Cambridge, I must manage it for myself. Early, I learned the lesson that a man could choose a profession, but a girl must learn to support herself. Presumably, this would be until she found a husband. But it was early impressed upon me that I could scarcely hope to do that, as I had no money of my own. Such was the Victorian social code in which I grew up."
Do you feel that Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin ever received the recognition she deserved?
No. I think, especially early on, people did not give her the recognition she deserved. That's partly because she was a woman, and she had to go through many years of not being recognized, not being paid well here at Harvard, until eventually she was given the important position she had as the chair of the astronomy, the first chair of the astronomy department. And even after that, I'm not sure that she received the recognition she deserved, because her findings were extremely important. I do think that women were not treated equally early on in the development of astronomy, and that's unfortunate, and hopefully we can look for a brighter future ahead of us. And that's what we are here to do.
After researching Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin, I submitted a proposal for Chatham Hall's iQuest program and was awarded funding to travel to Harvard University for 5 days over spring break in March 2013 with my AP Physics teacher, Mrs. Molly Thomas. We followed in the footsteps of not only one of the most important female scientists in history, but also one of the greatest scientists in history, male or female. In this quest, I learned about Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin's drive to excel and pursue her passion, regardless of the barriers, whether gender-based or not, that she faced on her journey. I hope to continue to study the sciences in high school and college, and the knowledge and experiences of Payne-Gaposchkin's journey will contribute to my future educational endeavors to a great degree. In addition to extensive research about Payne-Gaposchkin's life, I also interviewed 2 faculty members of Harvard University and 6 current women in science of several different generations, including 3 Chatham Hall alumni and 3 graduate students at the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. I interviewed these women about their experiences, obstacles, and reasons for pursuing science in an effort to visualize how the scientific community's acceptance of women scientists has changed since the time of Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin. At her time, equality for women scientists had improved considerably since the times of women scientists in the years preceding her, and equality for women scientists and mathematicians has made considerable progress since her time. It is my hope, and the hope of the women included in this film, that more progress will continue to be made.
Do you think women students consider themselves at all intellectually inferior to men when it comes to science and math?
I don't think they should, but if they do, it's probably because of the way they were brought up and what they heard during the early years. But it shouldn't be the case. I think gender has nothing to do with the ability of a person to pursue a scientific path. And there are examples for excellent, you know, for example, Madame Curie that got the Nobel Prize, and Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin that we discussed, and even in the history of the observatory here at Harvard, there were the computers back at the beginning of the 20th century, and they made very important discoveries. For example, Henrietta Leavitt discovered that there are stars that change their brightness periodically, and the period of their variability correlates with their how bright they are, how luminous they are.
We'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars.
Gretchen Clark, the first Chatham Hall alumna I interviewed, graduated in 1992 from Chatham Hall and is also a Virginia Tech graduate. She is a civil engineer and the president of Reynolds Clark Development, based in Gretna, Virginia.
Well, I'm a water resources engineer, and we design water lines and sewer lines. We also deal a lot with wetlands, and we try to create our designs in such a way that they don't impact wetlands or that lessens the impact on wetlands and streams. Why did you decide to become an engineer? What fascinates you about it?
Well, my father has a construction company, and he always encouraged me to look at engineering as a field. And so I did some summer internships even before college, and that kind of helped guide my career path and solidified that this is something I wanted to do.
Marion Wiggins is a 1978 graduate of Chatham Hall and has a geology degree from Appalachian State University. She has been a geologist for 25 years and is currently a senior geologist at Vulcan Materials Company. I was interested in geology because I was very outdoorsy. I liked hiking. A class called Geology for Hikers grabbed my attention. First, I was majoring in biology, but I just got hooked on geology, and that became more evident as I took more classes. She didn't encounter any negativity in college and said that her professors were very supportive. However, she encountered negativity when she entered the workplace. Not all geology is like that, but my particular area is very male-dominated, she said. I think it's gotten better. In my industry, it's a little rougher than in other science careers. I've seen change, but it could be much better, she continued. Elizabeth Steer is a 1973 Chatham Hall graduate, and she received her undergraduate degree in chemistry from the University of Virginia.
Currently, I am a consultant. I have my own business. It's after I was, my previous full-time position was Director of Analytical Sciences at PGX Health, which was a small pharmaceutical company in Charlottesville, Virginia.
What did persuade you to enter science?
I just thought it was fun. It makes sense, you know, you're trying to make things logical and understand why things are happening and how to do it, and there's an inherent truth to science. It's not something you can make up. It's not something you can make if it doesn't really exist. It's you might not understand it and don't know why things are happening, but there is a why. You just have to find out what it is.
The first graduate student, and the youngest woman in science I interviewed, is a native of France. She is a graduate of Harvard College with a major in astrophysics and is currently a graduate student at the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics.
In high school, I really had no clue what I wanted to do. I knew I was leaning towards the sciences just because the way I was thinking was more in that way. And then I took a year off before college, and I spent a semester in New Zealand, actually, at a university there to improve my English. And so I was like, I'm here for a semester in New Zealand. I'm going to take the most random subjects, something that I would never even think of doing for real. So I took astronomy because I'm like, oh, astronomy, that's so random, right? And I took that first semester and I really liked it. So when I got here, I took the intro astronomy course here as an undergrad and decided it was fun and interesting.
Becky Dawson is also a graduate student at the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. Prior to becoming a graduate student, she graduated from Wellesley College.
So I first became a little bit interested in astronomy in, I think it was middle school, because I was on vacation and would always bring along a lot of books to read, but I ran out of my books, so my dad lent me the book that he was reading, which was a popular science book called The Brief History of Time by Stephen Hawking, and it had all this cool description of like wormholes and black holes and time traveling and things like that. And it was just really interesting, so I found some other popular science books on that subject to read. So then when I started college, I thought it'd be fun to take a whole class about this. So I signed up for an astronomy class, and it was a lot of fun, but actually it turned out that my favorite part of the class was when we were learning about planets. So that summer I got to work with the professor of that class on a research project about planets, and that was a lot of fun, so that's what really convinced me to start seriously pursuing astronomy as a major and then go to graduate school.
Courtney Dressing is a graduate student at the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics and a graduate of Princeton University.
I grew up outside of Washington, D.C., and I went to Thomas Jefferson High School for Science and Technology.
Oh, okay. So did you focus on science in high school?
I did. I actually managed to take astronomy, so we had required senior research projects. My senior year, I worked with a scientist at the Smithsonian Institute to study dunes on Mars. I was always really curious about whether there were other beings in the universe that were looking up in the night sky and wondering if there were other people there as well. And the more I read and the more I learned, I realized that was actually a viable career path. So I went to space camp when I was little, and then I took astronomy in high school and started doing research projects and realized that I really like doing research. I like serving as a teaching assistant in classes. I like working with younger students, and I thought it was really a good fit.
What are some examples of science classes you took in college?
I took a bunch of astrophysics and physics classes, so things like stars and galaxies, cosmology, electricity and magnetism, mechanics. And then I also wanted to try out some other sciences, so I took a course on basic chemistry and a couple classes in biology, including things like genetics. And one of my favorite classes was taking an astrobiology course that kind of brought everything together and tried to figure out what you need to have a habitable planet. I work on the Kepler spacecraft, which is currently orbiting the Sun. It's following the Earth in its orbit around the Sun. Kepler's staring at 100,000 stars, monitoring all of them to see if any of them have planets. And the way Kepler does that is it monitors the brightness of the star, and then if a planet passes in front, the star appears dimmer. And based on how much dimmer it appears, you can tell whether you have an Earth-sized planet or a Jupiter, because the Jupiter would cause a much bigger dip because it blocks more of the star's surface. And my project in particular is looking at the smallest stars studied by Kepler. The reason why we care about those is that although we might think that the Sun is a common star, it's actually a lot bigger than most stars. And 75% of the stars in the nearby galaxy, in our section of the Milky Way, are actually only about a quarter of the size of the Sun. So you need to look at these small stars. So I'm figuring out how many of them have planets and how many of those planets could be like the Earth.
Do you ever remember being treated differently at all because you were a woman studying science?
Being treated differently, not in an explicit, obvious manner, but do you know XKCD? It's like an online webcomic, and it has one that really illustrates like sort of a feeling that I sometimes get, which is there's this guy, he writes some wrong equation on the board, and somebody sitting next to him says, oh, wow, you're bad at math. And then there's a girl who does the same thing, and then the person sitting next to them says, oh, girls suck at math. So it's kind of like, there's always this stereotype associated with, you know, being a girl in science. And when I'm in a classroom and I'm like one of three girls, when there's 40 guys, I really do feel like I'm representing all of like the feminine gender, you know, and that there's this feeling there, which it's not really like being treated differently, but it's like feeling differently.
When I started as a first year, they were graduating their first year of undergraduate women. So the actual women's room in the restroom in the chemistry building was a reconfigured janitor's closet. And so the facilities were very different, and they were not used to having undergraduate women in the university. So
I went to a women's college,
okay.
That was actually really nice. I think it's somewhat avoided that. Like, I've definitely heard from people who went to co-ed colleges that sometimes you feel a little weird if you're, like, one of a couple women in your physics class. You might feel like you're a little bit different. But at a women's college, there's never a question of, like, are you not as good as this as the other people because you're a woman, or are you getting special treatment because everyone there is a woman? So it can be a nice place to go to college for that reason. I think if it were evenly split between women and men, that would probably be just as good too. Mm-hmm. But because in the typical college, women are very much in the minority in a physics class, I think for some women, and I think it would have been true for me, it isn't as comfortable as of an environment. So it's nice to be one of many women in a physics class.
Do you remember ever encountering any sort of negativity or being treated differently because you were a woman, either in college or once you entered the workplace?
Not in college. College wasn't, there really wasn't any negativity there, but in some of the civil engineering classes, I was the only female. In the workplace, especially as a younger engineer, I did experience a little bit of negativity, but as I grew more confident in my field, it's become less, I think.
At the intro physics level, maybe it's, you know, one-third, one-quarter girls and then two-thirds guys, but as you progress and you go higher up in the physics classes, it goes like, in a class of 40, there'll be 5 girls only. And that's just, you kind of get used to it, but it's still odd when you stop to think about it.
Do you remember ever being treated differently in high school or college because you were a woman studying science?
No, I don't. The nice thing, I think, is that I had a lot of good role models, and a lot of my professors growing up, even though the number of women in the department was small, the women in the department were very visible. So I never felt like I was part of a small group or anything.
How do you think the attitudes toward women studying science and women scientists have changed over the years?
I think it's really improving, at least in astronomy. If you look at the department here, if you look at the senior faculty, like Owen Gingrich, he's a very senior. There's no woman faculty of his age, pretty much. Then you go to, for example, Professor Loeb's age class kind of thing, and there is one. And then you go to the junior faculty, and there's two. And we just hired a new woman professor. And then you look at the grad students, and it's 50-50, essentially. So it's, you can really, if you look at the generations here at the CFA, you can really see the improvement. And in this junior faculty search that we just had over the past few months, I think 8 candidates were considered. 5 of them were women. The top, so they were ranked. The top 3 were women. So the top 3 favorite faculty candidates for the department were women. So I think that's, and it's not like they're doing any like explicit policy of affirmative action for women. It's just that there are more and more highly, highly qualified women in the field, and I think that's very good, and astronomy is really progressing in that direction.
How do you think the attitudes toward women in science have changed over the years?
As more women are in the workplace, I think that, you know, people are becoming more accustomed to it. The men in the field are becoming more accustomed to us being here, and I think it just takes time.
When I started teaching my class, for example, I could go, the class met at noon, so at 1 o'clock I could go to lunch with the fellows in the class because they could take me to their dining rooms. But the Radcliffe girls had to eat up here across the street in the Radcliffe Quadrangle, which was a long hike from the Science Center. And I complained to the Dean of Students that this was not fair. And what would they do about it? And they found that one of the houses did accept women for lunch. And so they got an affiliation for me there so that I was able to take the women to lunch as well. And I think it wasn't anything terribly special for me. It just seemed to me fair. But the women were very pleased and they noticed. This is an interesting list, by the way, because it lists in order all of the PhDs from this department. Now we've had over 300 altogether. Back there in 1950, let's say, there had been 46 of them altogether. So let me go back through and count how many women there are. 9, 10, 11. So there were one quarter of them in that from 1925 to 1950, and that was in the first 25 years. Now let's go to the more modern section and see how many we would find. 1960 to 1980. 7, 8. That's shocking, isn't it? It's gone down to 8 out of 100, 8%. So it's dropped from 25% in the first 25 years.
That's interesting. Do you have any idea why that is?
I don't know. They're admitting so many more students, but they were just admitting so many more men. Well, back in those early days, astronomy was one of the sciences where women could get employed, and they could work on photographic plates that had been prepared and brought in. But I am myself just as startled as you are in finding that statistic.
Why do you think currently there are fewer women in science-related careers or studying science than men?
I'm not exactly sure about that. In biology, there are very large proportion of women compared to in physics. Astronomy is better than physics in terms of percentage of women, but even so, it's far from being 50-50.
And so I think it is changing, and I think it's just, one, you don't have role models. If you don't have role models, it's not something that you can see as a normal. It's not something that you look as normal. And I know within my neighborhood, there aren't a lot of female scientists, so just for neighborhood children, you know, what do you do? I'm a chemist, and it's strange to people, you know. They say you might as well be an astronaut. They're rare, but they're not rare.
Do you think there are any negative stereotypes surrounding women in science or scientists in general? And what do you think should be done to correct those stereotypes?
It's sort of interesting. When my son was elementary school and he had to draw a picture of a scientist, and he draws the traditional wild hair male, you know, the crazy, and I'm looking at him and I'm like, well, you realize, of course, that I'm a scientist and I don't look anything like that. And his answer is, yeah, but that's what people think one looks like. And I think just the role models and to get out there and talk to people and to identify yourself as a scientist. Well, this is what a chemist looks like, so I think, yes, I do look like a chemist. And that is changing. Hopefully it'll be easier for you than it was, but I think if you have confidence in what you're doing and you enjoy what you're doing, then you can sort of tune out the rest of it.
You go to a field like history of art and architecture, and suddenly it's the opposite ratio of girls to guys. So I think because of those pressures and images, women might be more attracted to the so-called softer fields. And then I think another factor that's at work, and that I've experienced myself, is when you hit something hard, because, you know, math is hard, physics is hard, and you're struggling because it's, you know, first semester of freshman physics, there is this tendency to feel like, I can't do this, which is more of a feminine, like, it's more of a girl thing in those fields, because all these society things, that all these things that you've been told since you were born is that, you know, guys are better at this than you are. So when you hit your first difficulty, you might say, oh, yeah, I can do this. And a guy might just be like, what's wrong with this problem set? Like, you know, they might push the blame on something else rather than internalizing it as being incapable of doing it.
Do you have any ideas of what could or should be done to inspire young women to be more interested in science?
Yeah, I think the most important thing is role models. So in other words, appointing excellent researchers to faculty positions, female researchers, would stimulate more interest among younger women and would also demonstrate that it's possible to be successful. And I think that's the most important thing.
Did you have any role models when you were first entering science, women scientists?
No, I didn't really. And I think the going from Chatham Hall, you didn't have the negative parts going. It's not like, you know, you had to go in a class full of men to do your science, or you wouldn't get your date if you looked like you were smart or that you did something that was people considered male. It wasn't that I had models to follow, but I didn't have the negative, don't follow that. So I really could just kind of follow my own path.
One role model that I'm lucky to have is my own advisor. She has a great balance in her life because she has two young kids, but also still has this wonderful career in astronomy. So it's great to have an advisor like that who basically has, like, accomplished all everything that I might hope to accomplish someday.
Do you have children?
I do. I have two boys. And balancing the work life and home life is a challenge. And, you know, every family is different, but we just have to have rules about how we conduct our week. My husband's really busy, so, you know, we just have to cover for each other. And I've got great parents and great mother-in-law and father-in-law that help us. But if I didn't have that, I'm not sure that I could do what I do now.
What do you think hinders women from pursuing science careers? Do you think family life plays any role in that?
I think the burden lies on the social structure in accommodating the needs to have children. And having children should be a task that is shared between men and women. I think it's the duty of the society to provide a structure that allows women to pursue careers as much as men by compensating, either providing additional supplementary salary that allows the woman to bring the baby to a daycare place, providing accommodating time on leave for either the woman or the man, and making it an equal partnership between men and women. And I think the American system lacks that accommodation. That's one of the main reasons that the fraction of women in sciences or in business is smaller.
Do you have any opinions of what could be done to make women more and young girls more interested in studying science?
There is one thing that I personally feel quite strongly about is, at a very young age, you know, girls always have Barbie dolls and they all wear pink. I was actually on break just now. I saw a lot of, you know, kids in the streets or schools, and there's so much pink clothing. And it's, I always say, if I have a daughter, she was not going to wear pink, any color but pink. I just don't want to feed into those stereotypes. And I think if we could help break those down, that would be really helpful. So there's this company that was started by a woman engineer, and she makes toys for girls that are, you know, as constructive and as, like, challenging as Lego or toys that boys have. So I think if we could work from the start in that sense, that would help a lot.
So maybe having more encouragement to take classes, and also structuring the classes in a way that it's not meant to lead people out or be as discouraging. I think that can be an issue even in high school. Like, I remember being in my high school physics class, and we were learning about torque, and for some reason, at least the ones who are being vocal, most of the boys seem to be very familiar with torque from learning about cars. I was like, oh no, I'm already behind because I don't know anything about cars. I don't know anything about torques. But, of course, by the end, all the students in the class do the same thing. But I think it can be helpful to let people know, like, no, actually, you're not supposed to know about this already. But even though you're starting from the beginning, you'll be able to get through it and accomplish as much.
I think more hands-on, you know, just get in and try things and discover things. And it's sort of interesting. There are things that are considered traditional female traits that are also available in science. I'm an analytical chemist. So really, if you're an analytical chemist, if you like puzzles, you like mysteries, that would be appealing. If you talk to organic chemists who make things in the lab, a lot of them say, yeah, I also do the same thing in the kitchen. I like to cook, I like to create, I like to mix things.
As the saying goes, the sky's the limit. But for the female graduate students at the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics, the sky is intrigue, opportunity, and their passion. Not even the sky is the limit for them. And Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin certainly had a hand in making that a reality.
I would like to be a professor someday, but unfortunately we graduate more people every year with PhDs than we have faculty positions open. So I'm going to do the best I can and apply for postdocs and probably do two of those and then apply for faculty positions. But I would also be really happy to work at a NASA research center. So we'll see what happens.
Do you have any advice for young women interested in studying science and pursuing science careers?
I think my main advice would be to don't doubt yourself. If you think you can do it, you probably can. And to find people who support you in your goals.
I'd say it's going to be tough in college, depending on where you go and all that sort of thing. But when you first start taking those physics classes or those hardcore biology or chemistry classes, and the level is a huge step up compared to high school, you need to have faith in yourself. And I basically, after my first physics class, I was like, I am never taking physics again. And look at me, 5 years later, I'm doing a physics PhD. It doesn't make sense. But you sort of have to have faith and push on and don't think like, oh, I can't do this, because there's all these things at work in your head that you're a girl, you should be doing history. Or
I think the most important thing I did was the internships, just really exploring all types of science and engineering fields, and that really helps you decide what you like and what you don't like and what type of environment you like or you don't like. For instance, a laboratory versus an office, or working in the field versus working in the office. So the more internships you can do and the more workplaces you can visit, the better you'll be at narrowing your field.
Don't become discouraged. Like, actually, a lot of women I've talked to even now have faced some sort of discouragement. There's at some point in your career, someone will just sort of tell you or imply that you're not good enough at this to be able to do it. And that might sometimes be the case, but sometimes it isn't the case. Like, I've also heard women who are at college and might be having trouble at first, and the professor's like, well, maybe you should major in something else. I think that can happen, and that women need to just take that with a grain of salt, because basically there's two possibilities. It could be that you're not good enough at it, but maybe the more likely possibility is just whatever you're doing to study or to work on, the project just isn't working for you and you need to change something. So I think you should assume that that's the case before assuming that you're not good enough. But I think that sometimes women tend to immediately think that they're not good enough without considering all the other possibilities.
There are lots of exciting things that we can focus on in science, especially in astrophysics. There are still many unanswered questions as to what the universe is made of, is there life elsewhere, and we better not be intimidated or limited by structural or social constraints, but instead focus our attention on the real questions, irrespective of gender, irrespective of ethnic origin or economic status. We are all equal in trying to address these important questions, and I don't think that gender has anything to do with the ability of a person to provide an answer to these questions.
So do you think the battle for equality for women in science has been won, or do you think it's still going on?
I think it's still going on. There are still misconceptions, but I think people that have the right opinions can eventually prevail. So that would make it indistinguishable in terms of the career path of a woman scientist versus a male scientist.
And things are looking up, I think. It's moving up gradually, so right now things are much better for graduate students, and things are a little bit shaky still for faculty, mostly in terms of family leave policies, but that affects men as well as women. And hopefully by the time you and I are faculty members, or at the age where we could have been faculty members if we wanted to be, things will all be fine.
I will conclude this documentary with the words of Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin herself. Near the end of her autobiography, she wrote, "As I look back, I ask myself what difference it has made to me as a scientist that I was born a woman. As concerns the intellectual side of the matter, I should say that it has made very little. I am not conscious of having used any feminine wiles in connection with my scientific work. In fact, I do not see how I could have done so. In that sense, scientific work is inhuman. I will not accept the conclusions of another astronomer simply because I am fond of him, or reject them because I dislike him, though I admit there is a temptation here. Neither do I expect others to accept my arguments or praise my work because they like me, or to attack me because they do not. Some charming people do slipshod work, and some disagreeable people have made great contributions. I have said elsewhere that I wish that all scientific work might be anonymous. On the material side, being a woman has been a great disadvantage. It is a tale of low salary, lack of status, slow advancement. But I have reached a height that I should never in my wildest dreams have predicted 50 years ago. It has been a case of survival, not of the fittest, but of the most doggedly persistent. I was not consciously aiming at the point I finally reached. I simply went on plodding, rewarded by the beauty of the scenery, towards an unexpected goal. Young people, especially young women, often ask me for advice. Here it is, valeat quantum. Do not undertake a scientific career in quest of fame or money. There are easier and better ways to reach them. Undertake it only if nothing else will satisfy you, for nothing else is probably what you will receive. Your reward will be the widening of the horizon as you climb. And if you achieve that reward, you will ask no other."